Welcome to this quick tips video on how to flip your holiday script. Hello everyone, and season's greetings from the Devereaux Center for Resilient Children. The Devereaux Center for Resilient Children is a small but mighty team of individuals committed to our mission of promoting resilience in children and the adults who care for them. We have developed assessments, resources, professional development experiences, and a whole host of goodies that are designed to promote social-emotional health in children and, of course, reduce their challenging behavior. We're also very committed to promoting the resilience of adults who care for children. One of the resources that we've developed is called Flip It. Flip It is a four-step strategy for addressing challenging behavior in children. Over the years, we have learned that while Flip It was designed for younger children, it actually works for children and adults across the ages. So this is a strategy you can use with your preschooler, with your teenager, with your colleagues, with your family members, with all of your other fellow adults. As our holiday gift to you, we want to share some Flip It tips. My name is Rachel Wagner Sperry, and I work with the Devereaux Center for Resilient Children. I'm also the author of the Flip It strategy. While we hope your holiday season is full of peace, love, harmony, and joy, we also know it can be stressful, and that stress can bring out the worst in people and their behavior. So you may see some challenging behavior from your kids or your fellow adults. Flip It is a strategy you can use to help smooth out some of those rough holiday edges. FLIP is an acronym. It stands for F, feelings, L, limits, I, inquiries, and P, prompts. Consider trying to flip the next situation where you're in conflict with another child or an adult. Start with F, the feeling step, where you validate the other person's feelings. Then move on to setting a boundary. And then ask a question or an inquiry that will invite some problem solving. And then move on to prompts. The prompts is where you offer alternatives, suggestions, coping strategies, or other solutions. Let's take a closer look at each one of the steps in the Flip It process, starting with the F step, the feeling step. This is where you calmly and kindly talk to the other person about what he or she is feeling. This is where you can also describe to them what you're seeing and hearing as a result of their behavior. So let's use an example of a holiday conflict, and I'll use one of my own. My mother is calling me about 10 times a day to check up with me about the holiday meal that this year I am hosting instead of her. So the longstanding tradition is that she's hosted the meal, but this year it's been turned over to me. So she's calling a lot, like 10 times a day, no joke. So I can imagine that she might be feeling what? Anxious? Of course she's feeling anxious. This is a hard thing for her to let go. I could be annoyed, or I could respond by doing the feeling step and trying to acknowledge what she's feeling and where she might be coming from. So I may say something to her like, "Hey mama, I noticed that you're calling a lot about this holiday meal. I wonder if you're feeling really anxious about letting it go. It must be hard for you to see the holiday traditions change." Doesn't that sound so much better than what my typical response might have been, which might have been sort of short and rude and defensive? So see, just doing the feeling step can just flip the script and turn something that might be calm, tense, and hostile into something that is full of empathy and encourages us to really look at something from another person's point of view. Responding with empathy and addressing the other person's feelings isn't always our first response, but this holiday season, a little empathy can go a long way. Consider the next time that you're dealing with a tantrum from our child or working with a grumpy adult, consider doing a feeling statement as you kick off your interaction with them. And it might sound something like, "I see that you're doing blank. I wonder if you're feeling blank." Now that you've done the feeling step, it's time to move on to L, the limit step. And this is when you think about what limits or boundaries you need to set within that sort of challenging moment with the adult or child you're interacting with. Using the example of my mom, who is relentlessly hounding me about the holiday meal, I have acknowledged her feelings. I understand that she's anxious, but that doesn't make it okay for her to be calling and calling me relentlessly. So now is the time for me to, after I've acknowledged her feelings, to set a limit. The limit I set should be positively worded, although, to be perfectly honest, I'd really like to say something like, stop calling me. But the challenge is, I need to find a nicer way to set that limit, a positive way to set that limit in order to establish my boundary and assert my confidence that I can handle this meal. Limits with children can be easier than setting limits with adults. There's a power difference there, and it's easier to positively word a limit with a child. We have positive words for kids, like we use safe touches, we keep each other safe, we keep our things safe, we listen with our ears, we use our walking feet. So that all feels pretty comfortable to us. But setting limits with grown-ups can be a little bit more difficult, so I really have to think about my boundaries and my expectations of the situation. So the limit I actually want to set with my mom that's positively worded is, I got this, Mom. I got it. That's my limit. Let's put the first two steps together. With my mom, I start with the feeling step, and that's where I say something to her like, Mom, I noticed that you're calling a lot about the holiday meal. I could tell you're feeling pretty anxious about letting it go. My limit statement is, I got this, Mom. I'm a good host. This may not change her anxiety level one bit, but at least I've set my limit and established my boundaries that I have confidence in myself. So now what? I care about how she feels, but I've set my limit. It's time to figure out what we're going to do about it. This is when we move on to the third step in the flip it process, the I for inquiry step. Inquiries are when we start with asking open-ended questions to engage in problem-solving with the child or the adult that we're in conflict with. Raise your hand if you're worried that we're raising a culture of kids who aren't really good at problem-solving. Most of us share this worry that kids are growing up really with a lack of skill around problem-solving. So why is that? Why are kids today less able to problem-solve? Perhaps it's because our culture's become way too quick fix and everyone wants instant access and instant solutions. Perhaps sometimes we're guilty of being too quick to fix things for kids. And maybe perhaps all of us are a little uncomfortable sitting in that discomfort of not having a solution, sitting in that messiness of not having the answers. But it's in that discomfort, it's in that messiness that true learning and innovation can happen. During this step in the flip it process, we ask inquiries to invite thinking, to invite moving through that discomfort and finding answers. The best kinds of inquiries are open-ended questions. Open-ended questions cannot be answered with a yes or a no. So rather than asking a leading question or a closed question like, should you be doing that right now, which could only be answered with a yes or a no, try asking an open-ended question like, what else could you be doing right now? As you can hear, there are so many potential answers and possibilities to an open-ended question. Back to the situation with my mom. As it stands, I've done a feeling statement where I've said something like, Mom, I noticed you're calling a lot about the holiday meal. I can tell you're feeling pretty anxious about letting it go. My limit statement to my mom is, I got this, Mama. I'm a good host. An inquiry that I might be able to ask my mom to get her to be part of the solution is, so what can we do to make you feel more comfortable about all of this? So here's a quick tip. Nobody really wants our advice. If I told my mom what I thought the solution would be, she'd probably tell me why it wouldn't work and all the reasons why it was a terrible idea. So the trick is to ask the person, the child or adult you're in conflict with, a question that helps them be part of finding the solution, because people are much more likely to use a solution that they think they came up with rather than a solution that I came up with. Make it a we instead of just an I. Consider using an inquiry the next time you're in a conflict with a child or an adult. Try something like, how do you think we could fix this? Or what are some ways we could work together? Or even, what can we do to help? A wise person once said, it is not our job to have all the right answers, but our job to ask all the right questions. But just because you ask a great question doesn't always mean you're going to get a great answer, which is why we move on to the fourth step in the flip it process, which is the prompts step. Prompts is when we offer our solutions, ideas, suggestions, and alternatives. The key is that these are offerings, not mandates. When we prompt, we're lighting the way to solutions and resolution. But that doesn't always guarantee that the other party is going to see the light the same way that we do. So when we're prompting, we have to be prepared to be creative, keep trying, and compromise when we're offering prompts. So I'll tell you something, folks. I noticed that people are actually pretty good at this step. We're full of great ideas. The trouble comes when we skip all the other steps and just start offering our ideas. So try to make sure that you don't forget to honor someone's feelings, set your boundaries, and try asking a question that's going to invite the other person to be part of the solution with you. The trouble comes when we skip those steps, so don't skip any of those. So when I asked my mom in the inquiry step the open-ended question of what can we do to make you more comfortable about this, she may come up with a solution that's completely agreeable to me and we're done. Or we might both get stumped, which is when it's time to move on to the prompt step. I might offer a prompt that sounds like this. How about we try to have a scheduled call, maybe once a week on Saturdays, where we talk about all of the plans and you save all your questions for that Saturday call? And my mom might counter and say, one call a week isn't gonna work for me, I need two, which I kinda knew was coming and I had already prepared myself to compromise and agree to that prompt. So we now have an agreement that we are going to have two calls a week where we discuss all of her holiday questions and concerns, and I can prepare for that, and we're gonna get through this holiday together. So you see how we've just followed the four steps to flip our holiday script. So this example is just one of many possible challenges that could create tension in your holiday season and put a strain on your relationships. Let's say that your child is very excited about the holidays and won't sleep. This can become a very common power struggle between parents and kids. And so rather than engaging in the power struggle, consider trying to flip the situation. What is your child feeling in that moment of excitement before a big holiday? Well, they're feeling super excited. So the feeling statement to your child might be something like, I know you're really excited about the holiday and really excited for the morning. The limit needs to be, we go to bed at 9. That's your limit. We go to bed at 9. The inquiry might be something like, what can we do to help you get some sleep? And the prompt might be a follow-up and offering of a suggestion like, how about I rub your back for 10 extra minutes? I know what you're saying. I don't have time. I don't have an extra 10 minutes to rub my child's back during the holiday season. I've got things I gotta do. But to be perfectly honest, you don't really have time not to, because you probably don't have time for the 1 to 2 hour power struggle of him coming in and out of his room all night long. So it may be worth it to invest that 10 minutes of back rubbing that you offered when there wasn't a conflict versus all the things that you're probably going to give into when the conflict actually occurs over that 1 to 2 hours of power struggling. So notice that a flip will actually help the child to learn about their feelings, learn what your boundaries are, and know that you're there to support them in problem solving so that eventually, someday, they'll be able to problem solve this on their own. What we know is that children who are flipped about the little things will learn how to problem solve and handle challenges and have confidence in themselves to be able to handle those challenges when the big things happen. The last tip I want you to keep in mind when all else fails and your flip starts to flop is to go back to the feeling step. Sometimes the person that we're interacting with just needs us to sit in that feeling step and validate their feelings for a little longer, or sometimes an entirely new feeling has appeared and the person needs that feeling acknowledged and validated before they can move on. And really, think about it. When feelings are at the root of all of our behavior and all of our behavior is motivated by feelings, it's really imperative that we get to the root, that we get to those feelings in order to address any of the problems that we hope to resolve. We hope you find this quick and easy acronym easy to remember this holiday season during challenging moments where you feel like you might need to flip your holiday script. If you would like more information about the Flip It strategy, check out the website www.moreflipit.org. Or if you would like to learn more about the resilience building work we do at the Devereux Center for Resilient Children, check out our website at www.centerforresilientchildren.org. From all of us to all of you, we wish you a peaceful holiday season and a happy new year. Thank you for joining us.